Hello everyone tuning in. Today we are starting another show of Idea Lab, where we delve into ideas how to make money using mainly online kind of businesses. And today we have an idea how to productize your service and make a profit out of it. And for that, first, what we have on the menu, I'll show you next slide. So today we'll have quite an accomplished guest, Dan Norris, who has his own business running for quite a while called WPCurve. So we'll go over how he's running his own business, how he started, and what kind of activities he does. And you'll be able to ask questions if you tune in into live chat. And also I'll present my own example, how I started my own idea business using the same methodology, and also the ideas that Dan wrote in his book 7 Day Startup. And then at the end of the show we'll have a discussion where I'll shoot some questions to Dan, and anything you want to ask as well, just tune into a chat box and post there. So let's start off first with my idea, and then maybe Dan will have some comments later on. So idea is basic. I wanted to get involved with podcast industry because I thought I was a podcast listener myself, and I was thinking what kind of problems I can solve for podcasters, and I came up basically with a few problems that are most common. Of course, I haven't done my podcast myself at that time when I was thinking, and therefore I was more like brainstorming. So a couple of ideas I had heard from my podcasters, basically, that there's not much of analytics. That was first my idea, to maybe improve podcasting analytics. And then another idea, which I was thinking, where people who are involved in podcasts already spending money on different problems, and where it would be quite simple to do service or business out of it. So that was how I gave birth to a transcription service dedicated to podcasters. And here is the sort of a snapshot of a site I just created before. Basically, I'm just targeting specifically as a niche podcasters, and I'm offering them like custom-made transcripts where you can use for blogs, emails, and other mediums. So where to begin? Basically, before the new year, I was thinking how to actually start any kind of business and have some kind of instructions or guidelines. And I came across Dan's book called 7 Day Startup, which it's basically just the steps you need, the bare bones, where you can start any kind of online business using 7 days. Basically, when you put yourself into the time frame of 7 days and put a deadline on it, you can actually have some results, tangible results, after the 7 days, and you can even get your first customers. So the first thing is, as I said, a few steps. First, you find the niche, find a problem, decide on the name you want to do for your business. And then you do like a simple WordPress site, which can be done like in single day, hosted and themed. And then I come up with a marketing plan, which I'll go in the next slide. And basically, that's it. Once you're out of the door, then you actually can start getting their marketing out, get their word out, and just roll with the idea and see if it actually works. If it doesn't, you can actually fail much faster than spending like a year planning out, and once you launch, there's no no, like, you don't know if it will work or not. It's basically ties into the MVP idea, like minimal viable product, but you could call it even minimal viable idea, which you can validate. So these days it's almost impossible to like do an online business and thinking that clients will come to you without doing anything yourself, as there's so much noise and competition everywhere. So there are ways how you can market your business and basically choose which channel is working for you. And to choose that, you need to just, as this phrase I liked from one of other person who did the similar style business, is just try a bunch of stuff. So what I tried myself, and I can tell you what actually worked, was I just tried a bunch of stuff. Like, I tried blogging first, seeing which articles to write. This ties in basically into like content marketing, where you not just blog for the sake of blogging, but you tailor content that solves problems and actually gives value to the reader. So that had a reasonable result. It helped mainly for SEO, like for some keywords, which I didn't expect to work that well. We got ranked on Google like second page, even some of them like first page. So that was a like medium success, but it didn't get many clients. And then the next things is like social, basically Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn to some extent. And Twitter was the only channel that actually gave me my first client. It wasn't expected, because I see Twitter as very spammy these days, where everyone tries to promote everything. It's really hard to get through the noise. But if you target specific niche, you might get out a message and get someone interested in your business. And if you have like a follow-up and you're monitoring your channels, you can get someone through your sales funnel. And then the last thing, which I'm still continuing to do, is podcasting, because I'm targeting the niche podcasters. It's quite reasonable to do a podcast myself and see what the actual problems are, and see I'm not biased to myself. And this helped me to network with other podcasters and actually trying to gain the connections and see, validate the idea, if what I'm doing is actually of value, and then get other ideas, what kind of services would be useful for podcasters and what kind of problems we face. And also learn about the industry and what does it mean to be a good podcaster. So there's a lot of value in doing that, because it's a bit involved but fun as well. And the last point I want to touch is actually to run a business and to start something fast. If you're like doing a full-time job, might be a little bit hard to do if you do it only by yourself. So one of the ways you can improve and grow more is to utilize the freelancers. There's a biggest site for all the like, you can get any freelancer almost for any job. It's called Upwork. Basically, you need to have specific roles what you intend to do, and productized services, I think it's very suited like to running your like operations using freelance, at least for the first few months. Once you start getting more revenue, you can maybe hire someone full time, and you can with basically minimum of cost, hire someone to work part-time. Like, for instance, I have a transcription service and I hire someone who's just gives like a few hours a day or 4 hours a day, and he can just do one transcript for me, which I can send it to a client, sell it to a client as well. So that's one of the ways you can bootstrap your business using your own money and don't need to like have some investments. And it's pretty easy way to grow at first. And actually it's good way to also test the people you want to hire. Like I did for using Upwork, I just did like a small jobs we are willing to do for free. And this way you can just test if a freelancer is actually any good and reliable, and can he do like quality work. But as for freelancing, it takes a while to find good people and to like get it going properly if you're doing it on an ongoing basis. And of course there's a additional cost that you have to pay 10% to Upwork. So, and the last point is probably related to operations, like managing work can be, I think, quite overwhelming at first, especially if you're running everything yourself. So to mitigate that, try to like write down the processes, steps, how to run your service, and think about how you can actually get out yourself out of a business, so the business could run without you. That's, I think, the main idea of a productized service. It's more like a product, and you can scale it to bigger levels. So, conclusion: basically, find a problem or an issue, and how to solve it, and see if you can solve it profitably, and then try to hire fast, so you can actually get customers and satisfy their needs, so it wouldn't depend just on yourself, and then create and iterate the process, so the process won't be as good at first and you won't get it right at from first time. Just try something and iterate and see if it works for you. All right, and we'll have discussion a bit later. Now let's get back to Dan. So can you tell me a little bit about WPCurve now? Did it change like the growth when you had like in the beginning? How much did you have to like change the processes and actually the actual business itself? Did you have to bring in some new people, or what kind of steps did you have to do to reach the 1 million revenue a year, as I heard you did already?
We've got a team. We've got team leaders in each location. We've got about 40 contractors around the world. The business is pretty much the same as it was from day one. It's just a slightly bigger scale. We've got a system to manage the team. A lot of tools we use, Slack and Trello and a bunch of others to help Scout to manage jobs. We've got our own system that we use. We've got processes for hiring and firing and everything else. Other than that, it's pretty much the same business. It's people email in their jobs. We fix them on the same day, and they're more or less happy. I guess we have a few challenges. There's training up new staff is always a challenge. But it's essentially the same thing as it was. The systems aren't that much different. I'm not hands-on with the service anymore. That's probably one big difference. So I can focus on growth and marketing and putting out content, which is what I like to do. But other than that, the service is pretty much the same. It's a fully remote team. We don't have any employees. I work out of the Gold Coast. My co-founder is over in the US and everyone else is kind of in between. Most people in the Philippines. But I think we're in seven contractors in seven different countries. And yeah, it's pretty much the same. It's just a little bit of a bigger scale.
How crucial was making finding a partner, and was it hard to find someone to partner up, or did you like knew already before from some networking?
No, Alex just met me sort of through the blog. He reached out to me and was in the right position at the right time, I guess, where I needed someone over in the US, and he was there ready to work. And so we started working together, and it led to us both owning half of the company each, or more or less half each. And I think it was at the time I really needed it, because I needed some way of building the service over on that side of the world. And I didn't have any staff there. And I also sort of felt at the time I'd never had a business with other people, and I was just sick of doing it all by myself. And I kind of felt like I needed to partner up with someone. It was sort of just happened randomly, and the timing was very good. Happened right when I needed to find someone, and for him, it was right when he needed an opportunity as well. So it was good timing.
It's probably crucial to say that this wouldn't happen if you wouldn't have been like producing a lot of content before, and then actually doing the groundwork, like doing your blog, doing your podcast, and then trying to connect with entrepreneurs.
Yeah, I think that's true. I think a lot of the stuff that's happened with WPCurve, a lot of the attention we've got, a lot of the influencers and affiliates and customers, it's all been a result of the content we've been doing over a lot of years. So I can trace back most of the big things that have happened with any of my businesses back to content, including meeting co-founders and investors and customers and all sorts of other things. For all the businesses I work on, it seems to be a consistent theme.
Yeah, I think that this ties in that... I mean, you just have to get out yourself into a wild and actually start doing something, and then once you do and connect to people, especially entrepreneurs, you're learning, then you can find ways how to provide value and then actually build a business. All right. And can you tell a little bit about WPCurve, maybe, or in general productized service? Maybe we touch a bit how to you can measure if a business can be profitable, and what kind of correct pricing you should do.
Yeah, it's always a bit of a tricky one. I don't think you'll really know until you start, but you can make a few assumptions around how much it's going to cost you to have a customer, and then just make sure that there's some decent profit margin in there. So if it's going to cost you $100 a month to have a customer, you really need to be charging probably $200 or $300 a month to really have any kind of business there. Because eventually it's going to cost a lot more than you think to have a customer. And what a lot of people do is they don't really think about that. They just start and just come up with a price that they think is reasonable. And they'll get to sort of 30, 40 customers and then hit a ceiling. And it's sometimes not as simple as just raising prices, because the market might not bear the price that you want to raise to. So you need to kind of do those calculations. I did them pretty roughly with WPCurve. I sort of estimated around about that it would cost us $30 or $40 a month to have a customer. And so we charged twice that. And as it's turned out, it hasn't been too far off, but probably underestimated a little bit. And as a result, we've added in higher level pricing plans and annual plans and stuff to increase the lifetime value a little bit. But other than that, it's been reasonably close to sort of what we thought it would cost to have a customer to what it is that is costing to have a customer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's crucial. I mean, I was biased myself a little bit when I started doing this. It was quite a good advice you pointed out first time, that pricing was a lot low, and then I started to break down the actual cost using just bare Google spreadsheets, and I actually saw how much do I need to charge for the actual service to make at least some kind of a profit from a start.
Yeah, it's kind of hard. It's hard to do. You got to estimate absolutely every single cost and estimate, you know, what the business is going to be like when you got hundreds of customers, which is kind of hard to do. But it really is important to do. And the other important thing is you just keep reviewing it. You know, estimate at the start after you launch, review it a month after you launch, review it again, and just keep reviewing it until you're really confident that you know exactly how much it's costing to have each customer and how much you're allowed to, how much the market will bear in terms of you charging for it. If you can charge more, then charge more. But quite often charging more means less customers. And I always sort of wanted to have a business with lots of customers paying very little rather than a few customers paying a lot. And it's just, it needs, the reason I wanted that is because that reflects the kind of marketing I do. It's pretty broad marketing. A lot of people see it, but there's no really heavy selling. So we can't charge $1,000 a month because we're not doing the work to sell people at $1,000 a month. So there needs to be a nice fit between your pricing and your marketing. And I always thought that sort of sub $100 a month price point was a good fit for the sort of marketing I do. And as long as you're making a profit on that, then that can kind of work out. But you've got to keep measuring it over time to make sure that the calculations are actually correct or close.
Actually, I liked your idea when someone commented it's much easier to charge 10 customers, get 10 customers that pay $100 instead of one customer that pays 1,000.
Yeah, it's easier for me and for the marketing that I do. It might not be easier for everybody. Like some people like doing that heavy sort of high touch selling, in which case it might be easier to sell one customer on $1,000 a month. But it has to be. It's kind of hard to scale that though. So you need to have a bit of a plan for scaling that. And I didn't want my marketing to rely 100% on me. So I wanted to do the broad sort of content marketing and then get other people in to write the content, which I've done, and keep that growth going without me.
Okay. Do you think like a productized service business kind of is for everyone that can anybody start that kind of business, or you need some kind of special skills before you can do this?
I think you need to be able to deliver what you promise to a high standard. So depending on what your business is, you need skills in that area, or you need to be able to hire people who can do it. I mean, that's just fundamental. You need to offer a good service. You need to be an expert at what you do, or you need to work with experts at what you do. I think that goes for any business, not just a productized service business. So you're either going to have to get really, really good at whatever you're offering the service in, or you're going to have to find people who can offer it really well. And if it's going to be something you can scale, then you need to be in a position where you can find those people ongoing, which can be challenging because if it's a really specific skill, then it's going to be much harder to hire for that. So you need to keep that in mind when you come up with your idea. And I always... The reason we went with the 30-minute small WordPress jobs is because I knew I could hire guys in the Philippines pretty cheap, and there's a lot of them around to do the work. And if we had to hire, you know, guys in Australia to do this work, this business wouldn't exist because it would cost us 10 times as much. So you need to factor that into when you're planning your idea.
Yeah, good points. And one interesting thought... If you have like a time machine right now and you can from now go back to the time when you just got the idea for WPCurve, how differently would you start the company? Would you do something differently at that point?
I don't know. It's kind of hard to say. I mean, if I was going to launch a business now after doing WPCurve, I probably would do some things differently. I'd probably just have a really good think about how like ongoing in nature the service is. Like I think like with WPCurve, we have pretty good retention, but we've always got a challenge with people signing up and getting stuff done and then leaving, which I think any productized service is going to have, any membership's going to have, and really any recurring service is going to have, or recurring business at all. But I think if I was to do it again, I'd probably choose something where it is really something that people need absolutely every single month. And I don't know, although I don't really have any other ideas I can think of that are better, because the fixing websites is very core to sort of what I do and what I'm known for. So I don't know if I'd really change too much, but I would give a lot of thought to what's a problem that is never going to really be solved. Like that's what a recurring service or product is. It's solving a problem that is ongoing. It's never really going to be solved. It's something you're always going to need. And that's something that I think people get wrong. You know, that they package something up that's not really an ongoing service, but they charge a monthly fee for it. And if you do that, people are just going to leave. So retention is probably our biggest challenge. So that's probably something I'd spend a little bit more time on. And that's probably the main thing. I mean, the other thing I'm doing a bit more now is building a team locally where I am in my office and not going 100% remote. And I'm finding that better. It's just better for getting stuff done. It's quite challenging to have a 100% remote business. So I think if I was to do another business now, it wouldn't be 100% remote because I just find it too challenging to work that way. So that's probably a change I would make.
Yeah, and I would say like if you compare like what we have right now, use Skype and other technologies, it's some businesses that couldn't exist like 10 years ago. Right now it can because of like a lower cost if you hire some freelancers in Philippines or in other jurisdictions. So it's interesting that the new opportunities pop up that you maybe like 10 years ago, someone who's stuck in that in the past, they still think that someone is impossible, but due to internet and new like tools we have, we can create some new businesses as well.
Yeah, there's a lot of opportunities out there. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah, and one more thing I'm interested in. As you mentioned, you're really into the content marketing thing. Do you have like a specific like process or as we call it sales funnel, how you bring in the customers, and can you touch on that? What is your like strategy?
I mean, it's basically just creating content that is highly actionable, is the best, you know, in the class for this type of content, and then giving people an obvious next step. So if we do an article about, you know, a marketing guide, what's something we can entice them with for their email as like a lead magnet? For example, the week before last, we did a post on lead magnets, and the call to action was sign up and get this lead magnet kit with a free ebook cover and free ebook design templates. And you know, 5 to 8% of the people who read that are going to take that option, give us their email address, and then go onto our sequence in which we pitch them WPCurve. So that's basically the strategy. Do as good a content as possible, have call to action for every post, have a pitch sequence based on the topics people are interested in. And that's all done with Infusionsoft lead pages and just a content team and a designer for doing the lead magnets. And we focus on the amount of leads generated from each piece of content. And that's our main metric for each month is how many leads we can generate from the content. Yeah, that's pretty much it. I mean, the only other part of it is really just working out what goes well, constantly reviewing the stats of what content's going well, and doing more of what's working and doing a lot less of what's not working, being really ruthless around what gets accepted and what gets rejected, making sure what's on the site is actually really good, sharing it in my 7-day startup community, getting a conversation going around it, sharing it on social media. That's pretty much the strategy, and the tweaking we're doing really is just trying to constantly get better and better at doing great content, get nicer images, better calls to action, better lead magnets, and just tweaking every part of the process. But fundamentally, it's about putting out good content and eventually getting people to consume it and trust us and get into our email funnel for WPCurve.
I think the first part is really important. Someone to be willing to give you money to solve your problem. You already like read 10 blogs of yours, and you know, or you already solved some of your problems. It's probably much more likely that they'll be like willing to try a trial of a service or actually becoming a customer straight away.
Yeah, it's very much about building trust over a long period of time, which is requires patience, but I know it works because I wouldn't be here if it didn't work. So it's just believing in it and constantly doing it, constantly trying to improve, and I think it pays off eventually.
Yeah, good advice. I'm just also thinking, it's are you like on the board for like 4-hour work week mindset, and how much you actually spend time on your business, like primary business, probably is the WPCurve.
I don't know. I mean, I've got a few different things I'm working on, but I think WPCurve is definitely has the most amount of potential from anything I'm working on, and I think and is the biggest in terms of revenue at the moment. So that gets quite a bit of my focus. I'm very much on board with delegation and having processes and making sure you have a team that does all of the key work for you and not doing everything yourself, which is very much inspired by the 4-hour work week. But I'm not so keen on the idea of working 4 hours a week because I quite like working. And if I was only working 4 hours a week, I honestly don't know what else I'd be doing because I like working too much. So.
Yeah, I think people sort of like a design to, in a sense, evolve to do some work. If you're not working, then you're becoming a vegetable. So, and if you're doing something that you like, or you say passionate about, doesn't feel like work. Is that something that you feel about WPCurve, or is it other things?
Yeah, I think so. I think if you build a business around your skills and build it in a way that, you know, has you doing the sort of work that you love to do all day, every day, then it doesn't feel like work. And if it does feel like work, you've probably gone about it the wrong way, I think, or maybe you're not actually that excited about being an entrepreneur. But yeah, my there's very few things I do that I don't enjoy doing and that really feel like sort of work.
Again, you actually, based on reading on your book, you pushed yourself pretty hard when you had your agency, and as you said, it wasn't that kind of work you enjoyed, but you still did it for quite a while.
Yeah, and I didn't want to make that mistake with this one. You know, really, by the end, that sort of felt like a job, and I'd sort of built myself a job, but not a very good one. And so I didn't want to make that mistake this time. I wanted to make sure I started a business where I knew the sort of work I was doing every day was going to be work I enjoyed, and I think that's really important.
Yeah, wonderful. All right, so maybe for our last points, can you give like some insight for anyone who's thinking about maybe starting a productized service? Where should we start, and what things we should concentrate on?
I guess just make sure it's an ongoing problem that people have. Don't get too carried away with the idea or with any kind of planning or anything like that. Just try and start doing this work for somebody. If you can get someone to pay you, then that's the best case scenario. If you can't, then just do it for free. Get testimonials, get proof. Make sure you can deliver it really well, and that you know, you've got people that are raving about what you're doing. Even if they're not paying you, then that's still proof, and that's still people who are going to refer you to other people. And eventually get to the point of building a brand around what you do, make it really referable, execute it really well, make sure it's priced with the ability to scale, get good at procedures, and then do the kind of marketing that's going to get a lot of attention for your ideal customer and keep growing it ideally. Or if it doesn't work out, then give it a good crack and try something else.
Yeah, as you like constantly mention, don't be afraid to fail, because that's part of a process, being an entrepreneur and actually doing businesses.
Yeah, just treat it more like an experiment where you're trying to figure something out, and if it doesn't work, then you've learned something and you can move on, and then you can learn something else, rather than a sort of a personal failure, because that's really what's required. I think that you're gonna screw up a lot of things if you're anything like me, and if you take it personally, you'll probably give up eventually. But if you treat it more like an experiment, I think eventually, ideally, you'll figure out how to make it work and achieve some success.
All right. And maybe you can just give a we have listening about your things you are up to, projects like 70 startup and the black bears. I don't remember how you call it exactly, and just that and where we can find people you or follow you, read your blogs, because you're doing so many things. It's hard for me to track all of them.
Yeah, I've only really got three things on the go. WPCurve.com, you can check that out, or WPCurve.com/blog, which has got all our content on it. 7daystartup.com is my community for online entrepreneurs, and we do quarterly challenges where we help people start businesses. And blackhops.com.au is a brewery I'm launching, which is where I am now. It's actually downstairs from my office, and we're hopefully launching in about 3 weeks, and also do a lot of content on that site, blackhops.com.au/blog, where we have articles about building a brewery, and we have a podcast where we chat about building a brewery, and so pretty active on social media with all of those businesses as well. I'm at the Dan Norris, THE Dan Norris, on Periscope, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, Blab. I think that's about it. I'm pretty active on most of those platforms. And then 7 Day Startup Facebook group, you can join that for free and join in the fun and launch a business during our challenge.
Yeah, I would add that anyone who's thinking to starting something, project or just anything, really try the 7 Day Startup Challenges. It'll give you the motivation to finish something and get it out of the door. I think that's the main thing that everyone needs.
Thank you.
All right, then. Thank you very much for giving your time here and sharing the knowledge. We've had a little bit of technical difficulties, but I think we'll do some post-production and we'll get something out of the door.
Okay, yeah, hopefully it works out okay. I don't know why there was a delay, but yeah, hopefully it works okay. Thanks for having me.
All right. Cheers.
Okay. See you, mate.